This is Smart Money with Joe Smith and Julia Anderson.
All right, we're going to talk 529, and it's not an area code.
No, thank goodness.
No.
I am very excited because we have a guest with us today, Michael Parker, who is the executive director of Oregon College Savings Plan.
That's correct.
Is that
yes.
the way you say it?
That's correct, yeah.
And it's all about 529s.
It is.
So why don't we just kick it off?
Yeah.
What is it?
Yeah, what is it? What's the backstory?
So the backstory is the federal government passed a law in the IRS code 529 back in the late 90s. Required states to, if they wanted to hook into the federal tax code and offer a college savings plan. Our legislature did that in 99. We started the plan in 2001 with no dollars and no accounts. And now we're up to about $1.7 billion and 100,000 accounts.
Wow.
So it's people, I think, were really ready for it here.
You said $1.7
billion. Dollars in assets, correct.
Right. Okay.
We now distribute on an annual basis $200 to $300 million just in distributions for kids to go. So that's when you know it works.
Wow.
Right? You know that it's working because people are taking the money out now to spend on those college expenses.
It works like a 401k, right? Where you get to grow the money tax-free? Tax-deferred?
Correct.
Tax advantage.
Tax advantage. So I'll give you the
What's the difference here?
Yeah.
Right. So let me give you the tax benefits.
Okay.
It's an after-tax program, unlike your 401k or IRA. However, you get a double tax benefit. One, everything in the plan after you put the money in is tax-free. So if you take it out for college expenses, so you put the money in, it's not taxed by the federal or state government ever again as the money grows. The second tax break is every year that you put money in, the state of Oregon is going to give you a tax deduction.
If you live in Oregon.
If you live in Oregon and pay Oregon income taxes.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
So you're getting that double tax benefit. So people can feel comfortable putting the money in, knowing that all the earnings that they have on the plan is not going to go back to taxes. It's going to go directly to my college expenses.
Okay.
So if you live in Washington, you can still use the plan.
Yes.
Don't get that extra
correct.
Kicker from okay. Oregon.
Correct. Anyone,
I live in Washington.
Anyone anywhere. Now, the great thing about Washington is if you live in Vancouver but work in Portland, you're probably paying Oregon income taxes.
Of course
you can take the deduction.
Okay.
That's correct. As long as you're paying Oregon income taxes.
So who is really eligible to take advantage of this? Is it just the parents? Could I take advantage of start one for a nephew or a friend or
yes.
How does it work?
Yes, so everyone's eligible. You don't have to be related to the beneficiary that you open the account for. That's a kind of a common misconception. It has to be a parent or a grandparent, like you said. It does not have to be. Typically, a parent or a grandparent is opening the account. That's what we see mostly as that familial relationship. But anyone can open an account for anybody else. I could open an account for the neighbor kid that mows my lawn or does stuff for me or around the neighborhood. So it's open that way. Now, an important point is that these accounts can be transferred to family members. So for example, if I have four kids, two of them decide not to go, I can move the money to wait till they have kids and move it to there, move it to a niece or a nephew. I could take the money and go back and get retrained.
You can?
Oh, yeah.
You benefit yourself?
You can benefit yourself.
Oh, you
really?
Can.
Correct, yes.
That's, I love that idea.
I thought that would seem to be double dipping.
We talked to a lot of
you paid the taxes on it already.
Yeah. You did.
Yeah.
And we talked to a lot of teachers and nurses who put the money in, because typically teachers go back and get master's degrees. They can take advantage of the plan, get the tax deduction, and go back and get that training.
What a great idea. Now, that part I did not know. Okay. So what's the return on the investment if I am kicking in some dollars
That's
for
a good
this?
Question.
Sure. The return's going to vary depending on what investment option you want to invest in. I'll give you our most popular option. It's called our age-based option. Much like retirement works, where you're a young worker, you're going to put money more into an aggressive stock portfolio, this works the same exact way. Your child is young. We're going to invest that more aggressively in stocks. As your child moves, gets older, we automatically move that money to a more conservative investment as we go down the line. So much like retirement, as you get older, you're going to want your money a little bit more protected. This works exactly the same way. Each of those portfolios, there's nine of them that you move through, has a different return.
Hmm.
But what we have done with that product is we've really reduced the fees way down and made those investments more just tracking the market. So what the entire stock market is doing, it's kind of an index product, right?
I was going to say, it sounds
so
like an index.
So we don't we're not taking active management into it. It's all passively managed. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of just tracking the market for you.
So what are some of the investments my money is going.
Sure. So if you look at our age-based product and look at having an aggressive portfolio, we're investing in an index like an S&P 500 index. We're investing in a large fixed income or bond index that you're going into. So again, these are very, very low feed options that aren't taking that active risk of buying and selling stocks. They're just tracking the market.
Well, less than 1%.
Well, oh yeah, no.
Like 0.3%.
Like 0.3% on an annual basis.
So they're really good.
Yeah, so you're getting a really, really low management fee, and you're essentially tracking the market as you can do in any other stock
investment. And this is managed through TIAA,
Kreft. Right.
It's a big company that you contract with.
Correct.
So
we did a proposal. We went out and did a search. Now TIAA Kreft is a very large. Folks don't know that name. They made their mark really in retirement for higher education and nonprofits and healthcare. And they got into the 529 business because it was a perfect fit for them because they're already doing it for these other nonprofits and healthcare. It was a perfect fit for them to do that.
You know, it's kind of interesting.
You go first, Doug.
when a young couple first gets married and then they have children, they don't necessarily have the money at that point to put aside.
Correct.
But is it put whatever you can aside? Because, you know, by the time that child reaches college age, I mean, I can't even imagine what the cost is going to be, you know, in, 20 years.
Yes.
Right.
I will tell you that our biggest hurdle in this is getting folks to actually take the time to open the account. Once the account is opened, people generally will start putting money. I'll give you an example. We do a program called Baby Grad, wherein
Baby Grad.
I like
grad.
Grad.
Okay.
So essentially, we will seed your account with $25 if you have a baby. So you come to us and say, look, I had a baby 3 months ago. As long as the baby is less than 12 months, we'll put the $25 in. Over 2 years, we've invested of our marketing dollars about $37,000. So $37,000 of these $25, that $37,000 has turned into $8 million in contributions.
What?
Really?
Yeah.
That's great.
So it's just that opening the account. People will put money in. Yeah. Friends and family will put money in.
Right. It doesn't just have to be one.
Right. So it's just having the account open.
Rich aunt.
Right.
Yes.
I make the joke, the best way to fund a college education is to have someone else do it for you, right? So have other people putting money in. I tell my parents all the time and my friends, my kids don't need any more toys. They don't need any more. I have two daughters. They don't need any more dolls. Put $50 into their college savings account.
It really is GoFundMe, isn't it?
It is GoFundMe, and that's the best way to help do that. So we really try to tell folks, look, to your question, Joe, get the account open. Let folks know that you have the account for this child, and then you'll be amazed at how much money will start coming into it.
Now, I searched your website, and I looked around on what not only the fees were, which we've been talking about, but also what your average earnings are over time. Right. And if I read it right, it was about 7% a year?
Yeah, I mean, depending on the year, yes. And it really depends on that portfolio that you're in. But again, we're really just kind of tracking the market. So,
and that's for all of those levels?
Correct. Mm-hmm.
So your aggressive ones that are mostly stocks are probably doing quite a bit better than that.
Right,
7%
and then you get to that end where you're pretty much in
CDs.
CD, well, in protected or in very short-term bonds. But we also have other options that are just individual that don't move. Depending on what you want to do, if you're a person who really wants to kind of manage it more hands-on, you can mix and match. You can invest in several of our portfolios if you want to and make your own allocation. The age-based option with the 9 portfolios really is a kind of a set it and forget it. We'll do it all for you. If you just want to put the money in, we'll do all the reallocation, all the moving, everything. So you do nothing until you're ready to take the money out.
And that's most people, isn't it? It
but nationwide, that's by far the most popular.
Well, I'm glad you brought up nationwide. Is this universal across the country, but each state does their own?
That is correct.
Right.
Most
states do it.
Every state has a plan. They're all different to the sense that there's different state laws, right? So some states don't have a tax deduction like we have. Some states will charge higher fees, maybe they charge lower fees, just depending. But every state has their own plan, kind of puts their own spin on it. Right? But universally, they all are plugged into that federal code. They have to follow that federal 529 tax code.
Okay. Yeah. So what happens if a parent goes through the 529 and then the children that they have do not want to go to college and they die? Can you will that?
Who dies?
The parents.
Parents.
Sure.
Okay.
Can that be willed to somebody else?
We get this question a lot. The money in the plan it's important to note, belongs to the account owner. By federal law, you have to name a beneficiary because that's what's required, but that beneficiary has no right to the money. It's really the account owner.
Once it goes in there.
Once it goes in there, that beneficiary is on there, which can change, as I said, at any point in time. The owner of the account owns the money. So if the child doesn't end up using it prior to the owner's death, the owner can transfer the money to a different family member as he or she chooses. So you can move it around all you want.
Or right? To a charity?
To a charity, you can do whatever you want. If, in fact, the owner dies, the money would then would go down the line of succession. So let's say the owner of the account didn't have any heirs, it goes into that owner's estate. So again, what's important here, it doesn't just move to that beneficiary because the beneficiary is named, right? Mm-hmm. So it essentially is an asset of yours that would go into your estate and essentially either be liquidated, or if you have, we allow you to set the money up in trust, which a lot of older accountants are doing because, let's say they have 10 grandkids and they put a bunch of money in, they want to know that the money's going to those kids when they die. That's definitely what I would suggest, that the trust then would control those assets and dole them out to those grandkids.
That sounds like something you might want to talk to your estate planning attorney about,
I would definitely do that. We have an account form that will do a simple trust for you, a very simple one.
Oh, really?
Yes, but I always say that. I always say talk to an attorney or estate planning specialist because there's other ways you can structure it.
Sure.
But just know that we do allow a trust to be the account owner of the plan.
I am really interested in the flexibility for what the money can be used for. I think I understand there's a lot of options there.
There is.
And then two, I'd like you to get to the difference between if the owner of the plan account is the parent or the grandparent. Mm-hmm. Because I think there's some things that you might want to do differently depending on if you're a parent or a grandparent.
Yeah, so great question. So
the money
can be used for any required expense to go to a university or college or trade school. So what are those? So obviously tuition and fees, room and board, living expenses. Finally, Congress and the IRS gave us computers as a qualified expense for years.
Makes sense.
Wow.
Computers were not a qualified,
really?
Computers and software were not a qualified expense. when I was going to school, you know, a typewriter was a necessary. Now computers, like if you don't have a computer, you can't get through, right?
Yeah, you're not.
So that was finally a qualified expense. So again, let's say for example that you're in art school. All your art supplies would be qualified expenses. Mm. You can pay your apartment rent. You can pay for your groceries, you can pay for your, all that is, those are all qualified expenses.
Okay. But you have to prove this too, it isn't, don't
document
you?
It.
You
document it?
You, yeah, don't you?
Okay, and I'll get to your second part
That's
of your question.
That's fine, no rush.
The answer is it's on the honor system. So you don't have to turn receipts in.
Wow, okay? Great.
What I tell parents a lot, because they get worried about this,
well, sure.
Is I just have them keep the tuition receipt to prove the kid was in school. Because if the kid is in school, we know, the federal government knows how much it's going to kind of cost to send your kid to Oregon State or Oregon or Portland State. So let's say that your kid goes to OSU and you're taking out about $20,000 a year, which is, you know, give or take all in, then okay, you're fine. It's called the cost of attendance.
Mm-hmm.
So as long as you just keep that tuition, that, you know, I prove the kid was in school, then it, I think it's fine. Yeah. So it's good for folks to know that all expenses that's required for that kid to be at that institution are qualified expenses, up including computers.
Wow.
What's not included, I think it's important to say what's not included, you can't buy a plane or train ticket home, okay? You can't buy a car.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Oh.
You can buy
a
gas.
Car?
You can buy your gas for your car.
Oh.
Right?
Oh.
So that, because I have to get to and from.
Right.
To and from. But a lot of times folks think, well, you know, the kid's got to get there. Well, yeah, he's got to get there, but that's not a qualified expense.
Oh, okay.
You brought up a good point about financial aid, because I get this question a lot.
Right. Well, I talked to a guy at Portland State University for the column I wrote about 529s, and he was explaining that most students now, because it's so expensive, it's like if you're, you know, it's like $25,000, you know, whatever.
Right.
Anyway, it's awful. So most kids are financing their college through loans and family.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 529 fits into all that mix.
Right.
And so there's some ways to best utilize them.
There are. It's amazing the maneuvers you can potentially make. So to your point, most families are doing what I call a three-legged stool. They have a 529 or some sort of savings, so 529 or some other savings account. They have debt or scholarships, And then, unfortunately, they have just current income. As you're as a parent and you're working.
And this is the parents we're
talking
about.
Right. You're writing the check every month to send off to your kids. So those are the three most popular ways that most families are kind of combining it to pay those costs. However, with 529, the federal government has given us some breaks, because if you're a parent and you own the 529, as you're filling out the free application for student aid, the FAFSA, the 529 is only they only look at 5% of your 529.
5.4%.
5.4%. Yes, thank
Sorry,
you.
Sorry, I read that.
Yes,
I know that.
They're not looking at every point counts.
They're not looking at 100% of it.
Exactly. So it's a very small amount of that money.
Correct. Now, if you are a student that has a bunch, so if you're the student and let's say that you have a bunch of money in your bank account, the federal government says, well, that should nearly all go towards. So they're looking 100%. At 100% of it,
okay.
Right?
Wow.
In most cases.
Okay.
Let's move to grandparents. So a grandparent-owned these are the rules that I love. The grandparent-owned 529, okay? Mm-hmm. So if the grandparent owns all the 529, the feds don't see it as an asset, right?
It's not on the list.
Okay. It's financial aid is most all based on parent income. That's what it's all based on. So they don't see other 529s that are for that kid. They don't see it, okay? However,
There's a however. Right. It's tricky.
Once the grandparent makes a distribution to that child, right, then the next year they apply for financial aid, they consider that income to the child.
Okay. So
and affects their,
and that messes things
up. And that messes things up, because then that's again a lot higher percentage,
sure.
Right?
So then how do you get around that?
You get around that by now really having the parent own all of the assets.
Yeah.
We are actually looking. I belong to a national association, as you can imagine, folks in my business. We're looking at ways to make the grandparent-owned 529 plan be treated the same as a parent-owned 529 plan.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Would be nice. Right.
Or you could have the grandparent give the money to the parent.
Correct.
Put in.
Yes.
You hold off as a grandparent until their last year of school.
Yes.
And give the money to them that last year, so they're not going to be reapplying for any more loans, so it doesn't matter.
Or graduate school.
Yes, that
is correct. So we want to make sure that grandparents still contribute. We don't want it to look like a barrier, but they can contribute, and then when the kid's ready to go, they can either transfer the account to the parent.
Oh, right away.
And
there's no penalty on
correct
how
correct.
Sooner
or to
you do
what
that.
To do what you said, just wait until their last year and then pay for that last year's school.
Okay. Yeah. I didn't know the part about transfer.
You can transfer the account. Okay. Tax-free and penalty-free, you can transfer an account.
So we've talked about how great this is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. What's the downside?
Well,
is there one?
It's a little complicated on the distribution end.
The downside. I mean, if you want to ask me, the downside is that you sort of have to figure out again how to make those distributions, right? How to figure out how to navigate the waters, because there's still that 5.4% is going to count against you. Now, a lot of people think, well, I'm not going to save anything. I've heard this from families. I don't want to save because it's going to mess up my kid's chance for financial aid. As most folks now know, financial aid
is going to do it.
Isn't going to do it.
Right.
And or it, there's no free the free money, the real grants are really for those folks who really can't afford to send their kids, mm-hmm. like really can't afford. If you have a decent household income, you're not going to get any need-based aid, mm-hmm.
right?
You might be get merit-based aid.
When I was talking to the guy at Portland State, he said that only one-third of the students who apply for like Pell grants or federal grants, that sort of thing, actually get them.
Yeah,
it's really
based on that family need. So they again, when you fill out that free application for student aid, the FAFSA, they look at what's called the EFC, the expected family contribution. So what you can pay and so they look at all your assets and then there's that gap. Well, that gap's got to be pretty big in order to get free money. If it's a smaller gap, you're not going to get, you'll get qualified for a loan potentially, but not that gap.
Okay.
And that's the other piece we haven't really talked about is this phenomenon of the student debt, right? And which is what we're trying to avoid. I got out of college with maybe $10,000 in debt. Now you're looking at, you know, three times that or four times that.
I've run across some horror stories, like $100,000 debt, and they have no way they're going to be able to pay.
And here's kind of where my public policy hat kind of comes on, because what we're really trying to do is reduce that debt so that when Oregon kids are getting and can come back and working here, that they can actually take their money that they make at their job and not just service that debt.
Right.
Because that it could be
you can buy a house.
You could buy a house, you can spend more money in the economy, you can kind of live. Yeah. If all you're doing is working to service that debt, that doesn't help our economy, that doesn't help the state. So the more we can get kids out of school with minimal debt, I'm not saying no debt, but minimal debt, then we're going to be better off down the road.
And you don't want to discourage kids from even thinking about college, knowing that at the end of the road, I've got all this to pay back.
That's correct. Yeah. That is correct.
So you're starting early in schools, which seems like a really good thing to do. You've got a program for it.
Yeah, so we have a new program, well, new last couple of years, called Be College Ready. And what that really means is when someone would say that to you, you might think, well, I got to get good grades and I've got to study hard. Yes.
Yes.
but we want to highlight the fact that you have to be financially ready. Be college ready on the financial side, or just prepared, right, to understand the ins and outs of how to finance it. So what we've done is we've partnered with elementary schools around the state. We provide homework folders for elementary school kids, pencils, pens, bookmarks, and then some information that would go home to the parent about, okay, we just want you to understand, even if you don't put money in our plan, understand what it's going to take to get your kid in through school. Maybe you don't want to use our plan, but at least there's an awareness factor, right? So we want you to be college ready on the financial side as well. So again, for folks out there who haven't heard about Be College Ready, go talk to your elementary school principal. We're giving out all the free materials right now. The program's going on now through February in the schools. And again, it really just is a way for us to highlight what we do and make you aware the plan is out there. And so, maybe it even spurs you to do something even outside of us.
So do you hand out brochures or do you go do workshops?
Both.
Or
both. Okay. So what we do is we allow you to order the materials for the kids so everybody gets a homework folder and all that stuff. And then we will say to you, look, we're happy to come to your school and do a parent night. We'll come and do a lunch and learn. Whatever you want us to do, we'll come and do that. We were talking before we started airing that we have outreach directors who their job is to, I don't want to see their faces. They should be out doing these kind of things. And they're out around the state 2 to 3 weeks a year doing presentations, talking to families, talking to civic organizations about, again, just about the awareness factor. Because parents don't, I mean, if you don't think about it, you don't really, you wake up one day, my kid's 14, and wait a minute. What's this going to cost me that much to go?
Yeah, three more years and boom.
Correct. So we want the kids, again, at the elementary level, kindergarten is great, to just be aware of it. And again, maybe you put in $25 a month. You know, it's just getting that account open as we talked about earlier.
Yeah. Excellent advice.
Do other states do this?
Every state does some sort of outreach. Be College, I will pat ourselves on the back a little bit. We at our national association that we talked about 2 years ago, we won an award for kind of the most innovative one of the most innovative programs.
Pat yourself on the back.
But yes, every state does some sort of marketing like this. But again, it's really trying to raise awareness. We're not trying to push our plan on you. It's out there if you want to use it. We have low fees and great investments, and it's state run. But just understand, it's going to cost you some money and some planning to get your kids in and through school. So just start thinking about it early.
Okay. Well, Michael Parker, excellent information. And boy, I mean, the bottom line here is, do it early and do it often,
know,
putting money
and
in.
And if people want to find out about this, there's two ways to do it, right? Your website and a phone number.
Website and phone number. OregonCollegeSavings.com is our website, and then our 800 number is 866-772-8464.
Okay.
And I'll have those posted on my blog at 60andsingle.com, which is about money and women. Women and money.
Great.
Awesome. Okay.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
It was kind of short notice. We really appreciate it.
No, I love it. This is fantastic.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
For more information about today's topic, log on to Julia Anderson's website, 60andsingle.com.